Good evening and welcome to the 5-8, where we discuss each of the week's five most fucked up topics for 8 minutes. Five topics, 8 minutes, two hosts, a guest, some singing, a lot of curse words, and as many cocktails as we deem necessary. LB, how are you?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm good. I like your new hair style.
Thank you. That's yeah, it's a progress. I think this is the end. I've been slowly getting the short. We'll see. Yeah.
It's good.
It's good. It's a little, I don't know. I got to still fuss with it. It just happened today. So.
Okay.
Yeah. But thanks for asking. How are you?
Well,
you had a busy week.
I had a very busy week. As you can see, I'm back home. I'm no longer in Florida. And I flew back from Florida and the door of my plane did not explode and fall out into space. So I feel good. I feel like everything's okay.
Amazing. Yeah.
And my flight left 45 minutes late and got there like half an hour early somehow. I don't know. These planes can motor
it's
when they
amazing. Feel amazing. Like- yeah. How much time they actually can make up when they need to, when they're not worried about gas costs.
Yeah.
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 Metal to metal. We get there pretty quickly. Yay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we have some fun stuff tonight.
We do. We're
we had a good
kind
time.
Of a lighter. It's a lighter.
It's a lighter show.
It's a lighter show. And we're excited for our guest.
Yes, we are. Are we telling everybody or is that only the super secret?
Only the super secret people.
All right, you guys gonna have to wait.
People will figure it out. I think they'll figure
it
out.
If you're not in our little Substack community,
You don't know
who our guest is, but I promise it's amazing.
Yes.
All right. Well, do you have anything else to share with me or are we jumping in? What are we doing?
I think we should jump in. I got no jokes up front.
There's no up front jokes?
I did the joke about the airplane. That's it. I'm done.
That's it. You're done. All right. Yeah. I'm going to start.
Did you know with the airplane, like they found somebody's phone on the ground, like the iPhone, or whatever it was on the ground. It fell out of the fucking airplane.
I actually can't believe a child wasn't sucked out of that plane. Like I freaked out when I saw that. I'm an okay flyer. I'm not an excellent flyer. I'm an okay flyer. Sometimes I'm not, I get a bad vibe, but you know, and that Twilight Zone movie did scare the bejesus out of me with that. And so with the window and something out the window and the window. So yeah, that was very unsettling to see. So, and then they found bolts or something. They're like, oh yeah, we forgot to put these screws in. We were wondering what it's like, you know, trying to build furniture around this house. You know, you end up with like five extra things and you're like, oh, I'm sure it's fine. And then the bookcase collapses on your head. So I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. That literally happened, I think, like the day before I was flying. It might have been the same day. And I was
No,
I literally didn't even think about it at all. I'm almost like, yeah, whatever. Okay. I feel like it happened in Alaska. It's not going to happen twice in one day. You know, it's fine.
That's true.
Yeah. But the iPhone fell 30,000 feet down and worked.
Oh, I missed the it worked part.
You should put that in the ad. I mean, come on.
That's an ad.
That's an ad.
All right. Let's get to this. Enough with giving people free ads.
You know, we haven't done in a while.
What haven't we done?
Hurly bird.
Okay, forgot how weird that was.
It's so weird. It's so,
so weird. So this is Hurly Burly. We haven't done this kind of segment in a while. It's where we sort of, there's so much kind of depravity coming out of, and that image was Rudy Giuliani in the Borat movie, but there's so much depravity coming out of the Trump vortex or whatever the thing is that's taking us over, the monster, that we just have to have a Hurly Burly segment because there's too much of it. And this last week for me, there's violence. My mother says this, and it's amazing. It's like, and she said this throughout the Trump, you know, even when he was running, she's like, he's so pornographic. it's like everything comes back to some kind of sexual reference or what, just a cravenness, right? And that extends over into just looking at violence, you know, there's the sadism of it all. And just what comes, like the, this texture that he's brought forth from the bowel, you know, of the darkness and just spews it on us all the time. So I'm going to get to his thing, but I want to start, because again, it's all his part of this octopus that is the Trump world, with the Hunter Biden. Let's do some more revenge porn as he shows up. And that, you know, I don't know if you guys caught this, but Hunter Biden walked in to sit and listen to the committee that was discussing him, right? He has said, I will come and testify, but publicly. I think now there's something that happened just in the last couple hours where he's like, all right, behind closed doors. So he and his lawyers, great lawyers, went, and he's a lawyer. I think he has a law degree.
Yeah, he's a lawyer.
Yep. Came into Congress, and someone put an amazing track underneath his march. I tweeted it. His march into Congress was like a rap song of like, are you looking for me? Here I am. I'm like, here I go. So he came in, he sat there, and it was just horribleness out of the Republicans at him. They're really obsessed with him, and they're really obsessed with the sex tapes or the revenge porn that they've got on him. Totally, it's all they can think about is naked Hunter Biden. That is all they can think about. Right. And then they, when they talk to him and insult him, it's always around his sexuality or it's something. It's just constant. Right. It's just, it's, they're fixated. So Marjorie Taylor Greene was brought her picture. She always brings her show and tell, right? Because probably she spends a lot of time with Trump and he needs the show and tell. And so she was prepared with her show and tell. And, you know, Jamie Raskin called her out and said, you know, hang on, I'm objecting to this. We have not seen this. This woman has already put pornographic images, you know, on the into the congressional record and surprising us all. She needs some. And she's like, they're not pornographic. And he's like, well, you're the expert. Let's just come back to her. So hopefully everybody's seen that. You should go find that clip and watch that. And then, of course, they were pornographic.
Well, I mean, what's pornographic?
He got up and left because who's going to sit there and let somebody assault them? That's an assault.
Yeah.
I can't with this. And then prior to that, into the violence channel, right? That is the same sort of cravenness, this Caligula that we're living through, was Donald Trump giving a speech about and touching on the subject of families who have survived gun violence, losing a loved one to gun violence, especially parents of children. And in this household, sacred ground. Like, don't, what are you doing talking to, thinking you can talk to us about our grief and what we're going through? And, you know, came out and said, well, you're just going to have to get over it. You're just going to have to get over it. And let me tell you something. That is the worst thing. Get on with your lives. You're just going to have to get on with your lives, get over it. There's nothing more cruel that anyone can say to families who have gone through this, especially mothers and fathers, than that. Get on with your lives. It just was like, it brought a shudder through this house, and I don't know. We all want to just vomit, like really not. It's just, it's such a cruel, sadistic attack. It masked and cloaked in this, you know, magnanimous, you're just going to have to fuck you.
Yeah.
Fuck you. How dare you? There was that. And then there's Roger Stone. And you watch the Roger Stone thing, who's threatening people's lives and then denying he did. And then it's on tape. Nope, he did it.
Threatening. I mean, he looks like a Batman villain.
Well, he wants to. So he likes that. He likes to think he looks like a gangster out of a Marvel comic.
DC. He's second rate. It's DC. Sorry. Yeah. It's interesting. There was a phrase, nightmares of depravity. I can't remember. It was one of the evangelical, you know, one of the religious right leaders saying it in like the late 80s to the left, to the, you know, the musicians and the artists. Music now is just nightmares of depravity. And it's interesting to me how that side throws out terms like that and is sanctimonious and self-righteous. And it's invariably they're the ones doing the most creepy ass shit, right?
Yeah, no, I said this 7-8 years ago. You can't clutch your pearls with one hand and vote for a pussy grabber with the other. That you can't. Sorry.
Well, you can if you're Lindsey Graham. You can.
You got to pick. If you're Lindsey Graham.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I don't know that he would go for the pussy grabber. But, you know, certainly the assaulter, right? Certainly, we now know that Donald is, as determined by a judge in a court of law, a rapist.
Mm-hmm. Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yeah.
So it's this, we have within our country, this great divide that is because of the channels of information and the silos of information, and also people's true natures coming out and us all seeing, you know, who's really transactional, who's really craven and sadistic on their own. But this sort of thing where we're, those of us who aren't swept into the nonsense, into the madness, we're just like, how do we deal with this hurly-burly? How do we, you know, we're just, you know, the one thing we do just have to live through it to a certain degree, but I think fight against it as much as we can. And now we have that happening with these wars and happening like this sort of another divide coming in of like the nonsense and the pure depravity that people are not only believing in and engaging with in a way that they think is positive, but they're championing it. Terrorism. It's just, it's blowing my mind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You were talking about, I was thinking when you were talking about Trump saying, get over it. And I think the divide is really an empathy divide, because I don't think Trump is capable of understanding pain or grief or anything. I think if something happened like that, and if Eric, God forbid, something happened to Eric, I don't think Trump would care that much. I just don't think he's wired that way. He'd be like, does it affect me? No, great. Okay, fine. You know, I think not that having that chip.
Psychopathy.
Yeah. And I think a lot of the people that rally behind him are the same way. And that's what they have in common. And it's a meanness and it's a pettiness. And, you know, meanness and pettiness is the dark heart of Nazism, by the way.
Yes.
Anyway, we should move on.
It is illness. So, you know, that sort of hatred. But I was giving you a good segue into that next topic.
I know.
Yeah. I think before we get there, I just want like little button on what you just said, which was interesting, is it's not just that it's the pleasure they derive from it. There's a pleasure.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, that strings those three things that we just talked about. Roger Stone takes pleasure in being somebody who is a professional, international grade, military grade troll, right?
Yeah.
Blowing shit up and going, ha ha ha. Well, you took it seriously. But he's that. And he likes that. He likes these are people, in my opinion, who were very confused growing up when they were rejected or faced some kind of no, right? Just a no, even from a parent saying, no, you can't. And they're confused, you know, or you can't say that, or that's bad, that's wrong. And they don't understand it. They're not wired to get all of that. And that's what hurt them. Not what they did, not having a consciousness over what they did that might have been wrong, but that they got corrected and didn't understand it. And it's like it creates this wound, right? It's a weird trauma. It's like they get traumatized because they couldn't, they weren't allowed to get away with victimizing somebody. And then that in and of itself fuels this when they finally get an opportunity to flip the tables and say, oh ha, now I can make you feel some pain. Now I can make you feel like you don't belong. Now I can make, that's what he gave them. He gave, that's what Donald opened up. It's like, you get to be the one that's right. And you get to enjoy it. And even if you're dancing in their blood, literally, you just enjoy it. Like we finally get to celebrate the fact that we can control how someone else is reacting and feeling about something. And we are now, you know, puppeting them and then going, are you triggered? Right. So it's that. And I can't even go on and on about it, but I really truly don't have any answers for how to put those people back under the rocks. I just don't.
I don't know. Speaking of nightmares of depravity and pornographic things, I mean, Roger Stone, I mean, you know, glass houses, buddy. I've heard things. Can't say. Okay. Moving on. Okay. Prosperity Guardian. Okay. I was sort of working yesterday. So when this attack happened in the Red Sea there, I got a text from my son saying, why is Joe Biden bombing Yemen? And I'm like, I don't think that's what's happening. So I went in but that's the way that this is being framed.
That's the frame.
You know, in YouTube channels or whatever the hell. So I want to just talk about this quickly. I'm going to pronounce it wrong. I think it's pronounced Houthi. That's the people that these are. When they say Yemen, it's not really Yemen. It's a terrorist organization, basically a separatist organization that controls part of Yemen and is not recognized by the international, you know, community of nations. It's an Iran proxy. It's fundamentalist. You're not going to believe this, but they're child abusers and child rapists. I know. Crazy. And they're not pro-Palestine. They're pro-Hamas. So there's kind of a difference there. So the people are like, yay, Yemen, sticking up for... No, they're not sticking up for Palestine. It's a subgroup within Yemen who's at war with the actual Yemeni government that's supporting Hamas, Hezbollah, and Iran, okay? Mm-hmm. That's first. And what they're doing is, I have a visual aid because maps are helpful. Here is a map. You can see at the bottom there where the Gulf of Aden hits the Red Sea at the little narrow part. That's called the Bab al-Mandab Strait. And that's where the Houthis are. They're in that part of Yemen. So they can send ships out and they can shoot missiles at stuff going through that strait. Okay. And you can see the Red Sea heading north. You know, there's Saudi Arabia's up there, Eritrea, Sudan, Egypt, and Israel's up there. But there's lots of, and there's also the Suez Canal is up there.
I was going to say, there's a big canal up there.
Major waterway.
Yeah. Okay.
So what they're doing is they're attacking ships, not military ships, ships that are like bringing shit places.
Yeah. You know,
food, oil, medicine.
Rescue ships bringing stuff to the Palestinians as well.
That too. Yeah. So, okay. This is from Heather Cox Richardson, who wrote a really good summary of this morning.
Okay.
This is just a chronology. Okay. October 19th, these Houthis hit drone missiles at Israel. Doesn't work. On November 19th, they seize a Japanese ship with 25 people aboard. Again, not a military, a ship carrying stuff. A cargo ship, okay? December 3rd, they attack three more ships. December 19th, there is a naval protection group is formed by the United States and others called Operation Prosperity Guardian. I like that name. On January 3rd, we warn them, stop attacking the ships, motherfuckers. On January 9th, they keep attacking the ships. On January 10th, there is a UN Security Council condemning what they're doing, which wasn't unanimous, but nobody voted, you know, there were abstentions, but nobody voted for them. Okay. So basically the entire civilized world wants these people to knock this shit off. But they didn't knock it off. And today they paid the price. So what they're doing is they're disrupting the flow of things. I've talked a lot on this show.
International waters. Yes. International, not Yemen.
Sovereignty, you know, the sanctity of borders, and like Putin going into Crimea is a fucking, that's bad for the world order. And so is disrupting the neutrality of the seas. And that's what these guys are doing. So the strike was not just the US and the UK. It was also Australia, Canada, Denmark, Germany, the Netherlands, New Zealand, Korea, and Bahrain, which is an Arab country, okay? I think the Saudis are on our side with this, even though they don't want, they're too cowardly to admit it. That's what's happening. So they're there, they're causing disruption. They're trying to, when Jason Pack was on my show, he has that podcast about the disorderers. These are disorderers. They want chaos. They want disorder. That's what they're trying to bring. And, they're terrorists. That's basically what they are. And that's what this is. And it's being masked and presented as, we're the only ones sticking up for Palestine in the Arab world. We're Yemen, aren't we great? And that's just
I think it's also more of, in terms of the support, the idiot support that that they have here now.
Yeah.
And everything collapsing and all this stuff is collapsing, Yemen with Houthi, the terrorist organization that is within their borders is, my brain, it just went out of my brain. It's because they're aligned with Hamas because they want Israel wiped off the map. That's what they want.
Yes.
Their goal is that.
Well, here's their slogan. Okay. Arthur Snell, by the way, wrote a great piece about this because he lived in Yemen for years and he knows a bit about that. So the slogan for the Houthis is God is great, death to America, death to Israel, curse on the Jews, victory to Islam. So if you're supporting those people, that's what you're supporting. That's their fucking slogan. That's their bumper sticker. That's their make America great again. It's their fucking fuck Joe Biden flag. That's what you're supporting. You think you're being liberal and you're not. So learn something before you go out there on your campus and chant death to America, please.
Yeah, okay. It's not good.
It's not good.
It's fucking not good.
Read a fucking newspaper article. Christ's sake. Okay.
All right. I'm done. Pretty good. All right. You made up for the lost time too. So
good.
We have a minute and a half left.
I flew through there like I was flying through the Strait of whatever that's called without any interference from the Houthis.
Imagine that. International waters, everyone. That's what we're dealing with there.
Just stay out of there. We warned you not to do it and you kept doing it. Yeah. And now you're going to pay the price because we're the entire civilized world and you're not.
Yeah.
That's just how this shit works. You know, America isn't always wrong. Often we're right. Controversial statement. Sorry.
Controversial statement. All right. Well, things have devolved into idiocy. And maybe
have they?
Maybe we have a little nod to that.
Everything is stupid. Everything is dumb when Trump is your king. Everything is stupid. Leaving everything. Everything is worse with Nazis on the platform. It's all fascist and rapist and anti-vax morons in MAGA heaven. There's no doubt that they pulled down their pants just to count to 11. Everything is stupid. Everything is dumb when Trump is your king. Everything is stupid. We need every fucking thing.
I just noticed Four Seasons Total Armageddon.
I didn't know you didn't see that.
Oh my God. Good job, Chunk.
Oh my God. Good job, Chunk. Great thanks to our special producer, audio producer. Oh my God.
It's not Tegan and Sarah. It's Reagan and MAGA. That's what it is.
It's okay. The people who wrote that song, which was also Greg and I. So that one came out real fast, and now we all want an extended version of it. We want the rap. We want to go for it. So anyway, we'll send that out there on the on the Twitterverse.
I gotta put the banner. I always forget the banner.
Yeah, here comes the banner. All right, you know who isn't stupid? You know what? It's not stupid.
Our guest. Yeah, it's true. She's a journalist, an editor, an author of Into the Raging Sea, and her new book is called Making It in America, The Almost Impossible Quest to Manufacture in the USA and How It Got That Way, which dropped this very week. Rachel Slade, hello.
Rachel Slade!
Hello. We have so much to talk about. I'm so excited.
Yay!
Yes, thank you. Greg, LB, it's great to see you. Your hair is so slick, LB. I'm just loving it. I'm just enjoying seeing you on camera. It's lovely. Greg, your hair looks great too.
We love having you here.
You as well. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you had a busy week because the book is out. I've peeked at your Insta. There seems to be lots of things going on. You were at some sort of reading. Tell us a little bit about that. How's it all going so far?
It's been pretty exciting. So I had an op-ed piece in the Times a week ago, and that just got so much engagement. It was pretty intense. Clearly people want to talk about this. Clearly people want to talk about reviving. Actually, this should be the moment that we're really focused on reviving American manufacturing. And before we even get to that, though, I mean, you know, my first book was about shipping.
Right.
And it's fascinating to watch how the cognoscenti, like you and your listeners, your watchers, how you've all like really pivoted to start thinking about shipping in very salient ways, right? So when I first started talking about shipping to my audiences, you know, when I was talking about Into the Raging Sea, that was 2018. And I would say, hey, folks, like, this is a problem. You know, we're very vulnerable. You know, 90% of everything that we touch has spent some time on a container ship. And the really smart guys in Silicon Valley, when they talk about Armageddon, when they talk about why they're purchasing all these properties in New Zealand and their helicopters that will get them, the one thing that they're worried about, or that they have been worried about traditionally, is shipping shutting down, right? Because they were very aware, and now we're all becoming very aware multiple times now over the past couple of years about how vulnerable shipping is. We saw it when that ship got blown over in the Suez Canal and like blocked it for 4 days. And, you know, the numbers that were coming out of that were intense, right? Billions of dollars, you know, every day being lost because the canal was blocked. I think people started to understand the magnitude of what's happening every minute of every day of, you know, every week of every year. You know, hundreds of thousands of ships out there, and we absolutely depend on them. And so this whole thing that's happening, you know, right there in Yemen is interesting, because this is not a new problem. I mean, the problem of the Red Sea is ongoing, it's chronic. And, you know, for a long time, anybody who's watched, what was the movie about the captain, whatever? I mean, you know,
Captain there's
the Sudanese.
This is my ship now.
Yeah.
Right. So, you know, there's always been piracy out there. And my friend Rose George, who's British, actually took a container ship through the Mediterranean, through the Suez Canal, and then down the Red Sea. I think she went all the way to Hong Kong or Singapore, and she wrote a book called 90% of Everything. But it's really a narrative about what it's like to be on a container ship. And her narrative about going through the canal and then going through that strip that you showed us, the Red Sea strip, is harrowing, because everybody knows that there are pirates and other dangers over there, because everybody knows that this is like, this is our Achilles heel here, right here. You know, this is that little strip, shipping, getting things through. That's what the modern world depends on. So she said when she was on the ship, she could not leave her cabin. So this is a container ship that she took. She had to pull down her shades. She had to lock the cabin door, and she could not leave the entire time that this commercial ship with just 20 people on it was moving through this critical piece, this critical shipping lane on which all global shipping depends, on which all of modernity depends. Wow. So yes, the Silicon Valley, they know that this is a problem. They know that shipping traditionally, the communication that they use is behind in many cases. They know that a lot of people who are working on ships are unfortunately not that well trained, perhaps not that well prepared. Some of them are even enslaved. I've got all stories for you. Another really good book, by the way, for your watchers is Anarchy of the Sea, which is absolutely fantastic, beautifully written book about the horror of global shipping. Anyway, so I always get very excited. I mean, bad, good. I get very excited when shipping is in the news. And of course, this is an international coalition. And the countries who are involved, US, Canada, Australia, Bahrain was a surprise. But these are all countries that have been mulling over what to do with this particular strip of shipping, you know, for a decade or two anyway. So, yeah. You know, and there have been moments when they've gotten an international like police association to like
ask you that. Is there an international or an international coalition similar to a Coast Guard in this particular era that specializes in the threats in this particular area?
Yes, will be absolutely. But the problem is that nobody can, because it's kind of this ad hoc kind of international, maybe you could say even American led effort. It's expensive. And how do you justify it? And how do Americans justify the cost? So, you know, it really needs to be some kind of very clear UN effort, and it needs a lot of funding because, I mean, again, look at that map. I mean, it's a really long strip of shipping lane. Yeah. And,
and it's vital. It's like a vital artery in the heart, right? So
it really is.
It has to stay clean. And it has to, has to be healthy. And I would think that the UN, you know, that this is also what we're seeing now with what just happened with the Houthis is international order, peace, individual human rights. So, you know, of entire regions so that there's not atrocities happening. Rely on this being clean and healthy artery for shipping to move. So,
but I have to say, I think it's very smart of them to attack shipping. It's certainly our Achilles heel. I mean, I saw somebody just talking about how they were doing programming for Maersk. I mean, and all of this, right? You take all of this big bundle of wax, this big vulnerability. That's what informed my new book, Making It in America. Because I was very
as a solution, very, right? As a solution.
I mean, it's not a solution. I mean, it's not the silver bullet that's going to make everything go away. But look, the point is, you know, we're vulnerable, and the vulnerability isn't just like tactical. The vulnerability is also, you know, about ourselves, like how we think of ourselves. And then how we take that energy out into the world, right? So if we're not making stuff and, you know, we completely rely on imports for even, you know, military weapons and transportation and like all these key industries, if we're completely reliant on the global supply chain, how do we negotiate, you know, with good faith in these, you know, international conflicts? When we know that their very lives and security depend on, you know, this complex supply chain that's very vulnerable and can be attacked anytime. And that's why I think it's interesting that, you know, people are calling out America for going into Yemen, because America is actually extremely dependent on these imports.
Yeah. And we saw this during the pandemic. You know, with the medicines and there's all of a sudden stuff couldn't come. I think that's one of the interesting things. And then, you know, China has made a concerted effort with that new Silk Road, whatever it's called, to establish the shipping channels, and they do things like, and I think we talked about this before, and it's mentioned the, you know, they can undercut the shipping costs. They can subsidize the shipping costs to get stuff to the United States, which makes it hard for us to compete with it, because if it's the same and the shipping is a wash. And I think ultimately the goal is to put everybody out of business, right? And then they can do whatever they want.
Have you guys, I don't know if you guys, for some reason, Google Ads keeps feeding me these ads for Temu and Shein.
Yeah.
Have you seen Temu? Do you know what this thing is?
I don't know what this thing is, but I'm not touching. It feels like Shein, it's if you make an online purchase in it for people in anything that's fashion, you want to buy a shirt or you're buying whatever. You know, and where I am, it's basically you're going to buy stuff online. It tracks that. It's somehow the algorithm is very aggressive with this Temu and it's associated with it. And I don't know what it is, but I could tell, it's throwaway fashion, probably slave labor, and they really want to put it in front of me.
Okay. So I'm about to shed some light on all of this and actually on Amazon itself and what's been happening to us Americans. Okay. So America has this law, I think it's called de minimis. And the law is that anything shipped from abroad under $800 is not tariffed. And so the law was originally designed so that if you wanted to buy something handmade on Etsy from somebody, say in, Spain, that would fly under the radar, the US tariff situation wouldn't get involved. The problem is that people have figured out how to completely exploit this. So Temu and Shein are shipping, 600,000 packages a day into the United States.
Wow.
Okay, direct to American consumers. This stuff is not being tariffed. So it's super cheap. There is no origin tracing, so it's absolutely coming from the Uyghur, from where the Uyghurs are being enslaved to, farm cotton and, sew goods and that sort of thing. So while other fast fashion companies are trying to clean up their supply chains as much as possible, these companies have figured out how to get this stuff directly to you, American consumers. And so when people say well, why should I spend more than $10 for a t-shirt or $15 for a sweatshirt? I just want you to think for a minute about the cost of that, the actual cost of that thing. So ultimately what's happening is, we are just gorging ourselves on cheap goods that have been subsidized by other governments through currency exchange and through, very aggressive industrial policies. But ultimately their goal is to destroy our capabilities of taking care of ourselves.
Mm. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. And it's working. It's working.
Well, I'm on Proper now. So I'm big, because the other thing, the other part of this where it's also destroying the planet, all this, the clothing industry like that side of it is really the waste produced and the toxins produced. And then what it's doing to the communities that are making this cheap labor or slave labor is so bad for the planet. It's so bad planet.
Yeah. If you want to talk about the apparel industry, fast fashion, definitely, we've read a lot about that. The dyes that they use, I want to talk a little bit about the other end of that. So when we're done with fast fashion, what do? I don't know if you guys apparently this is not everywhere, but those bins, those metal bins in the middle of parking lots outside of, I don't know what your supermarket. And it says, put your clothing here. I think the one's called Planet Aid. You know what I'm talking about? Do you guys have these things?
Okay, I haven't seen it, but
else would we get rid of the clothes that we don't want?
Yeah,
right, exactly. Sorry, LB. I'm sorry. Maybe they're not in California.
Yeah.
Okay, so there are these big bins, and they have a big door that you pull down, and you dump your stuff in there. I've done it. I'm guilty. And you just walk away, and then you think you've done something good. So here's what I want to share with you. This is in my book, and I want to share with you. So it turns out that starting in the early 70s, that stuff was being shipped over to Ghana, which is, that little just the edge of Africa, West Africa, just sub-Saharan Africa. And what's fascinating is that in the 70s, the stuff started coming into Ghana, and this whole industry developed around repurposing the clothing coming from America for the African market. And it was actually, it starts out as a nice story, okay? So there were all these people, they got sewing machines, they started dyeing things because Americans are really big, Ghanans, I guess, were not so big, so they had to like tailor stuff. Anyway, this beautiful thing starts to happen where you have this incredible like second use for America's discarded stuff. And this is really cool too. The term that they used for the clothing, now I can't tell you the word in Ugandan, but I can say that the translation was dead man's clothes, because they couldn't otherwise explain why somebody would get rid of all these beautiful goods. So let that sink in for me. Anyway, what's happened is the quality of our clothing has so degraded, right? And there's so many toxins in the clothing that we now wear because it's heavily petroleum based at this point, which is just to even think about that. Like I just think of like, you know, birds sloshing around in oil. But anyway, that's basically what we are, but it looks nice, you know, for the 5 minutes that we wear. Anyway, so that's being dumped. That's still going to Uganda. Ghana. So it's like a billion tons of clothing is being dumped over there. They can't use this stuff anymore. It's toxic. It doesn't hold together. They can't, you know, re-dye it. They can't tailor it. It's not worth it. And so it is literally clogging up the waterways of Africa, our junked clothing that we're putting in those bins that we think we're doing such a great thing. And now it is an absolute ecological disaster. And the photos are out there. Yeah, it's depressing, man. It's depressing.
Wait, how do they put petroleum in clothes? I don't understand how that works. Is it because
the fibers, the fibers that they use, like polyesters and that sort of thing, that they're petroleum based. So polar fleece, I'm wearing cotton, but like fleece is petroleum based. It's plastic. They're plastics.
That explains why I don't like fleece, I think. I hate fleece.
Oh, I don't mean to get people depressed though. Hang on. So now let's turn this conversation, because actually there are better ways to do this. And we have the capability to do things in better ways. And that's what my book is about. So, you know, after I wrote Into the Raging Sea, which is a tragic story, you know, it's about the death of 33 people, and it's about corporate greed and all kinds of things, and just, you know, malfeasance and complacency and nature and global warming. I was like, I want to write about rainbows and unicorns. And someday I will actually write about rainbows and unicorns, but this is the closest that I could get. You know, I'm a nerd. So I ended up finding a company up in Maine, right outside of Portland, that is trying to rebuild the apparel industry in America the right way. So they are unionized. I mean, the right way for me. Like, it has to pass my test. So
yes, okay. Union labor, perfect.
So the products that they make are completely American sourced, and it starts from the cotton in Mississippi and Texas. The zippers are coming from LA. They're made in LA. It's like the last family owned zipper company in America. It's a beautiful thing.
I know exactly what you're talking about, actually. That's so funny.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I do.
The drawstrings are coming from Connecticut, the grommets, and every single component is American made. It's just such a beautiful story. And the founders also have this like beautiful story, because they are not rich people. They weren't like Harvard business graduates who spent, you know, 20 years raping and pillaging as private equity people, and then decided to invest, you know, a little tiny piece of their money in trying this thing. These are solidly middle-class folks who literally mortgaged their house to try to make this work. And they're doing it. It's a great story, I think. I hope.
What's the name of the company?
Yeah. American Roots. So then,
American Roots.
Say it again.
So the name of the company is American Roots. They are manufacturing in Westbrook, Maine, which is just outside of Portland. It's a husband and wife team. They're co-founders. The husband actually came from the AFL-CIO. So he worked directly with Rich Trumka, the former president, who unfortunately passed away 2 years ago. So Ben worked directly with him for a decade, and he went all across America and saw what happened when manufacturing left. And he knows the story just like you know the story. Manufacturing left because of greed. And Trump says that too. And, you know, Ben was like, I want to prove that capitalism can work with labor to rebuild community in America and do some good. I just think it's a great story.
It is a great story. And the people are really, really fascinating. And, you know, you do a really great job with it. The whole thing is like every page as you go down this. I know you got mad that I compared it to a D&D module, but you know, I meant it as a compliment.
I missed that.
So you mentioned the op-ed before that you wrote. And I feel like you told me that the book was sort of a manifesto. Which it doesn't read like a manifesto, certainly, but the op-ed is much more manifesto-y. So tell us a little bit about that. Like what is your what is the theme of the manifesto? What's the thrust of it?
Okay. My manifesto is basically like, we just need to rebuild capabilities to create all the things that we use as much as possible. So the Biden administration actually had a Build Back Better America plan that was very comprehensive. And there's a phrase now that we're seeing, and I'm really excited that we're seeing this because this is the phrase I think that everybody should be using in 2024, which is industrial policy. Woo! Doesn't that sound exciting? That's really catchy, right? So industrial policy is basically a really coordinated effort to return capability to Americans, the capability of making things. And it's expansive. You know, it starts with education, and it's like we can't stem our way out of this, but we can prepare young Americans to get back into thinking about like building again, making again, producing things. And that's like a really, it's actually an incredible sector of the economy. It's 11% of the GDP is American produced goods. And it actually keeps 15 million people employed right now. But the great thing about industry, like making things, producing, there are a number of things. I mean, I could go on forever, but I'll just highlight some things that I think are important. One, obviously, is that it helps us become more independent. The second thing is that it stimulates innovation. So just like think about where all the innovation has come from. It always comes from people who are actually like in it, right? Like they got their hands in things, they're working with things. There are a lot of accidents and mistakes that end up becoming brilliant inventions, right? In my op-ed piece, I mentioned, you know, we talked about polar fleece, and now we don't like it, boo, because it's synthetic. But, you know, polar fleece was actually the invention of Malden Mills, which is in Massachusetts. It was a family-owned mill working directly with Yves Chouinard, who founded Patagonia. He wanted a new fabric that could replace cotton and wool in the outdoor market, something that was like really light but stayed warm when wet. And that's how they developed polar fleece together. It was a collaboration. And the reason that it could happen was because Malden Mills was this very cutting edge factory, family owned. They dumped a huge amount of money every year into R&D, and they were ready to try new things. Like they were just waiting for people to come to them and say, hey, here's what I would like a fabric to do. Let's figure this out. So I live in Boston. A lot of that stuff is happening right here, right? There's so much development of all kinds of things. And a lot of that innovation is actually going abroad. So we're developing AI to help with manufacturing. We're developing, obviously, all kinds of robotics. And frankly, all of that innovation could happen right here. We could be producing things. The other kind of wonderful thing, I think, in my like utopian brain, if I let myself dream, is just what you guys have been talking about, like this generational trauma that has been driving a lot of like the cesspool political behavior that we've been seeing. Stick with me, guys. Walk into my world for just a second. Imagine that a lot of the anger and frustration that I think a lot of men, I'm just going to say it, a lot of men, American men, are feeling because they were left behind in the innovation economy, in the service economy. We can put those guys to work. I mean, to be in a factory, to be working with robots and machines, and to be programming AI, and to be, you know, producing things and creating things. That's a new field where I think a lot of young men would be really excited to get into. I work with kids who are applying to college, and a lot of them are into computer science. Obviously, computer science is like so popular at all of these schools. And I'm like, what are you going to do with computer science when you get out? So what they're doing, of course, is they're growing up playing video games. They love the video games. You know, they love all that stuff. They love working with computers, but they don't have a very big imagination about what they could do with these skills, what computers can do, what can AI do? And it's like, throw all of that energy and excitement and interest at manufacturing so that we can fucking build our way out of some of the problems that we've created for ourselves, the political problems, the climate problems, the environmental problems, the employment problems. Like, let's try this. Let's try it.
I like it.
The
lonely men problems.
Lonely men problems.
Yeah. Yeah. The New York Times writing about that. Not all men, though, Rachel. Not all men.
Not all men? Okay.
I'm kidding.
Only some men?
I love when people say that on, like, they get so offended they have to, not all men. You know, it's just totally ridiculous.
You're okay. We know you're okay. Great.
Maybe I'm not.
Maybe you're not. Maybe you're a lonely man and you need to go build some things.
I have this.
There's a thing up here where I live now where it's like, I was with this group last night that are newcomers, and I fished for some eye drops to give another woman my age who moved here with her husband. A lot of people come up, like they maybe camped up here or whatever, and then they come later in life. And so when your kids are like kind of flying the nest and you want property and you want, maybe you have a hobby or you want, like, it's just so beautiful. You just want to be in nature. Everybody was coming, like people from Colorado come here because it's easy. There's not this big city in the middle of, you know, or big freeways in the middle of you getting to your ski mountain, or you're just living in with moose, right? They're just moose. And when the signs say moose crossing, take it for real. A moose is gonna cross. Like that's where I am. I had to fish for an eye drop because she had speckle in her eye because she has had the speckler ceiling, because you have to figure out how to do all these things yourself. You're not necessarily gonna find somebody that's gonna show up or have a skill set. And you've got a lot of folks and a lot of men that have like side gigs, right? So they show up to, you know, fix your plumbing, and you want a referral for, you know, maybe doing some carpentry. Oh, I do that. Or your hairdresser is like, oh, no, I can do the electrical. And like, and maybe they can, maybe they can't, right? You don't really know. So what happening with a lot of us, and us moms, we're talking, we're like, I just want to go. There's a education place right down the street that's for where you can go and learn a trade. And I want to learn how to, you know, frame, because I've got some rooms I want to build downstairs. So, you know, it's like there's a thing happening too that's of, I really need people to have the skill sets to like build.
Yeah.
to actually physically build. And when you don't have that, you're so vulnerable. Like you can't, there's nowhere to turn sometimes. And I don't, you know, Los Angeles was such a different experience for, you know, over a quarter century, because there it's like, you can get 20 contractors in half an hour to show up and they're all going to give you competing bids. And then you're just sort of like trying to figure out who's a crook and who's not, you know, that's the biggest issue. But I don't know. I think your utopia, what you're seeing, is also sort of a future that we're all going to get kicked into at a certain point. Because guess what? You can go get your computer programming degree, but in about 2 minutes, there's going to be a computer program that's going to write the entire computer program that you just learned for you. And you're never going to be able to keep up with that. So
I think in the field,
they're going to be replaced. Those people are going to be replaced first. That's what's happening with the technology that AI is promising. Is those are the jobs. Those are going first.
That's probably true. But, you know, what excites me about some of the stuff that we're developing is the idea that customization will be much more common. And so that's, I think, where Americans can really excel, you know, not just obviously with apparel, but with all kinds of things, custom medical parts, custom cars, custom whatever you want. The idea that these programs can be quickly reprogrammed by technicians to create something new. And out of that then will be this like innovation economy. Where are we now? 3.0, 4.0?
Yeah, I think we're into the next will be 4.0. We're in 3.0 right now for sure.
We're in 5.8. Yeah. But we're in 5.8.
We're in 5.8.
The other problem with all this is the thrust of capitalism right now and where it's headed and what the priorities of it are. So you were telling me a little bit, Rachel, before we went live about the reading that you did at the Harvard bookstore and the conversation you had there. Not to put you on the spot, but you want to share that?
Oh no, it was pretty wild. So it was a dark and stormy night, Tuesday night up here in Boston, and somehow we made it from Brookline to Cambridge, which, by the way, guys, is a 2.5 mile drive, so it wasn't that far. But the place was packed, which was really nice to see. People really care about this. Like people are really just manufacturing. You know, it's kind of like Rip Van Winkle. Like we're all kind of waking up and saying, "Wait, what happened to us? Hold on, wait, we need to get this back." Right. But it was almost as if I had arranged to have a plant in the audience, because, you know, after the reading and having this great discussion with Farah Stockman, by the way, who is incredible. She wrote a book called American Made. I can talk about that a little bit too. Just incredible. Yeah. She actually did reporting in Indiana, following three factory workers as their factory was shutting down. Mm. And it was so upsetting because they were actually packing up the manufacturing equipment to send to Mexico, where the manufacturing was going to start up again. So the equipment, everything was the same, except the company was manufacturing in Mexico so that they could get cheaper labor. And in fact, the three people that Farah was following had to train the Mexicans, nothing against Mexicans, but like, the company had sent Mexicans up to train with the workers who were training themselves right out of a job on the machines that then they were packing up. It was just insane. So Farah's story is incredible. So hers is another downer. Mine's the upper. But anyway, as we were wrapping up this like really intense conversation, because obviously we have two very different points of view, you know, she saw the end. I hope I see the revival, you know, the renaissance, the beginning. This woman in the back raised her hand and stood up, and she was this very elegant, tall, blonde woman, and she introduced herself as a Harvard MBA. And she said, "They're going to revoke my MBA, but I really think that there's more to capitalism than profit." And I really think that we have to start thinking about all the stakeholders, the communities, basically right. She was parroting my
societal stability, right?
Yeah. Like when you set up a factory, you are responsible just not just for profit, but like the people you hire and then the community in which you have set up your factory. There's this thing called the multiplier effect. If you spend money in a location on the local economy, so if you buy local, that dollar actually bounces around several times before it leaves, because you know the people who made that thing in the local economy then go spend that dollar somewhere else in the local economy, and so that dollar kind of grows and grows and becomes more powerful. Now, don't forget, I mentioned. I know you guys are probably going to want to wrap up, but let me just say one more thing about this whole Temu, Shein, Amazon, right? So not only are they not paying tariff on that stuff, which is why that stuff is coming in. Tariffs are there just to slow down the influx of cheap goods, to level the playing field between, you know, very disparate economies, right? To discourage exploitation of labor. And that's why tariffs are there. But I want to mention something else, which is that when you spend money on a good that comes direct from China, those people are not paying taxes in America. It's not just tariffs. You're sending money out of the economy forever. It's not coming back. When you buy American, those people are paying taxes on their own income. You know, it will benefit you in some way at some point, probably sooner than you think. They are participating in your economy. And therefore, they are buoying you as much as you are buoying them. So that's my shtick.
Here. I love it. And I said this on the podcast that we did a while back. But, you know, if you go into, some of the cities where 100 years ago that were the centers of industry, like Pittsburgh, for example, where I went last year, which is beautiful. Downtown Pittsburgh, because they had so much money. And, you know, from U.S. Steel and stuff, and the people live there. So they built these great buildings because they wanted to invest in the communities in which they lived. And that's what the rich people at that time did. Our rich people now want to leave the fucking planet. They want to go to Mars. That's it. Yeah. It's so fucking lost. And I like, how much would it cost to just build a rocket and send them there? You know,
Let's get our boys on that, right?
Yeah, let's do some industrial. What was the word?
Policy.
Yeah,
industrial policy. Send your ass to Mars.
Industrial policy. Okay, so
industrial policy.
You know, right before I was
doing the outer space, Elon Musk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Bye. We can do anything. You know, I love when people say, but it's so, you know, it's so difficult to find American made goods, and it's a little bit more expensive. And I'm like, we fucking put a man on the moon like before I was born. Like that was X number of years ago.
Yeah.
I think we can handle this. I think we can do it.
I don't want to bubble burst about Poshmark right now, because I did discover it when I came. I mean, everybody always talked about it, and then I didn't do it until that. But I can say to you that when you buy the quality clothing, you know, and up here, another main company, again, don't burst my bubble. I'm sure that I don't know, but L.L. Bean makes stuff to last. It lasts. So we're buying the sweaters and the pullovers and this stuff. And I don't even know how old this stuff is. It's someone else's. It's in mint condition. I'm never going to have to buy it again. It's going to, you know, and that's what I want at this phase in life. I want to buy it one time and that's it. I don't want to do this anymore.
I'm with you.
I need the things to last, and I'm really happy that I'm buying something that didn't end up in that bin and then over clogging up the planet somewhere. and not buying. And by doing that, by upcycling that or recycling that, not engaging in, you know, pretty nasty industry at the moment of all that fast fashion. Yeah.
You just don't want to be a part of that. Like, it's over.
I really don't. Yeah. I'm also too old. None of that stuff is going to look good on me. It's not going to look good on my, it's just not.
Oh, honey, so, you look good in anything.
I don't know. No. All right. We so love having you. Do you want to stick around a little bit? I was late sure. coming in here, folks. I didn't get to chat to yeah. with Rachel.
No, before. She's going to say.
Okay. You're going to say. Perfect. Yeah. But let's remind everyone about the book. Let's hold it up one more time.
Hold it up one more time. Making it in America. Yeah.
Oh, and great. Show the end papers.
Oh, yeah.
You know, this is so much fun. Look at that. Yeah, that is, so we had an illustrator show how to make a fully American hoodie. It's really cute. It has all the steps. A hoodie is a very complicated thing to make. So,
yeah, there's a lot of parts to a hoodie, actually.
I have one, by the way. I bought an American Roots hoodie. So it's
love it. Okay.
Yeah. I bought it a while ago when you first told me about it.
I'm worried about our shop now. Maybe we need American Roots to supply us with the.
Yeah, shirt. I was going to ask you, like, our shop.
We have no idea. We just did the thing. So compatibility also being something that is very, as you get into customization. So we worked with something that we could customize for our show. We were very limited in the options of what we could choose that would be compatible with this platform. So just as a reminder of that, as you look into your utopian future, compatibility, compatibility, or you can't, you know, it's that without that, you might as well be clogging up the Red Sea. You might as well be stopping it because nothing's going to get from A to B. It's just not going to go. All right. So
our next topic. I did them backwards. I wrote them wrong.
We're going to do sports, guys. So it's like, we'll do sports first. Stick with us, Rachel. I don't know if you're a sports fan.
I'm going to say this. Literally no one watching this is a sports fan. And that's the point of this.
And that's the point. But some big news happened in sports. And we also wanted a lighter show because we knew you were going to come and cheer us up about the world. And so we didn't want to take everybody back down. All right. What happened in sports this past week, Greg? There's stuff.
Well, I want to, you know, this is a time I feel like one of my jobs around here is to take what's happening in sports. If it seems relevant that people might want to know what's happening without having to investigate further than however long it takes me to explain. So there's a couple of things. First of all, the NFL playoffs are starting this weekend, which NFL is football, American football, the good kind. And it's going to be there's a lot of fun games as these things go. It's going to be the Chiefs are playing the Dolphins in Kansas City tomorrow. It's supposed to be, I think, 11 degrees below zero. These really, really, really super cold games are so much fun to watch. Colin Kaepernick, we remember him, right? The guy
that
kneels down. When he was the quarterback for the 49ers, went into Green Bay on one of these days where it was like 20 below or something in his shirt sleeves and beat the fuck out of Aaron Rodgers, that's another name that we have to talk about. So this is Aaron Rodgers. I think everyone has heard of him. Maybe doesn't know maybe who he is. So I want to give a quick primer on Aaron Rodgers. Okay. Came into the league, at least he's 39 years old, came into the league a long time ago, drafted. He wanted to play for the 49ers. They passed on him, went to the Packers, was there for years and years, was always one of the best quarterbacks in the league, but only won one Super Bowl. So, you know, I don't know. It's a little bit sus. Pat Mahomes has already won two. And fucking Eli Manning on my New York Football Giants has won two. So Aaron Rodgers likes to walk around like he's this great dude, and he's got like fucking one Super Bowl ring, which he can wear on his middle finger. Anyway, he likes the spotlight. He likes to be in the news. He didn't like Green Bay, so he went to the Jets in the offseason, and this was a big deal. And the Jets just let him do whatever they want. He brought in his coaches. He brought in his friends who were players and all this stuff. And they were going to be – everyone was looking forward to the season, Aaron Rodgers. And I can't stand Aaron Rodgers, and I like the Jets, so I didn't know what I was going to do. And then in some sort of Greek mythological twist of fate, on the fourth play of the season, he ruptures his Achilles and is out for the year. Right. That happened a while ago. But Aaron Rodgers doesn't like to not be the center of attention. So he's always trying to say controversial stuff. Like he was the one that tried to pretend he was vaccinated when he wasn't.
Right.
And he has all these. Yeah, he clearly goes down YouTube rabbit holes.
He clearly does. He's going to be one of those people who thinks that pandas are people, men in panda suits, and not real bears.
Did he say that on the
Mac? No, but it's coming. Yeah. It's coming.
But he said, like, this week he said that he thought Jimmy Kimmel was going to be on the Epstein list.
Right.
Like, and everyone's like, what the fuck are you talking? What are you doing? You're not even playing. Shut up, man. You know, he can't. I'm going to tell you right now, I think what's driving this guy nuts is that Taylor Swift is dating Travis Kelce, who has more Super Bowl rings than he does. And he can't stand that he's not the most famous anymore. So that's it. That's Aaron Rodgers. The other thing that happened is three coaches left this week. Nick Saban, an Alabama college coach. I don't know anything about college football, but he was like super duper great college coach. He was sort of the anti Tommy Tuberville, if you will.
Yes. I watched a little bit about like the history of his thing this morning. And he is the winning most coach actually across the board, I think in pro and amateur, like what he did at Alabama with that team and how he did it is probably the greatest football coach of all time. So
except that he's not, because it's fucking college where you just recruit the best players and beat the shit out of these. The greatest coach of all time is Bill Belichick, who also is parting ways with Patriots after 20 some odd seasons. Six Super Bowl rings. The amount of accolades and victories and everything else, just completely off the charts. We here in New York will always remember him as the defensive coordinator for the New York Football Giants during their two Super Bowl victories in the 80s and 91. So he will always be, to me, Bill Parcells' defensive coordinator. And when I see him doing things now, I'm like, isn't that cute that he went on? It's like he's a little kid from my high school that went on to do this, but he's always going to be part of my high school. And for all the great games that he won and all the things, Eli Manning and the Giants beat him twice in the Super Bowl. Somehow. It's crazy, but it happened. And I'm sure that to his dying day, it will drive him fucking crazy. I'm sure. All the New England fans. So that's it. That's what's happening in sports. Nothing that exciting, but you're going to read these names. Belichick especially. You're going to see a lot about that. And and he deserves it. He really is the greatest coach of all time. Football coach, anyway. Maybe in anything. So also, Belichick and Saban are good friends.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw that too. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, yeah,
right.
Yeah.
That's enough sports. That's enough sports.
That's our sports. So people are moving on. We're getting a turnover. We're getting a new generation. The old guard has said, yeah, I'm ready to retire. I'm done with this for whatever reason. So it'll be interesting. I don't know. I mean, I would just like for the technology to continue to get better so that these young men who end up could be great contributing members of the community with families and children don't crash their heads in. I'm just so opposed to how that sport conducts itself with the safety of its workers. Mm-hmm. You know, yes, they get paid a lot of money, but the cost isn't worth it. I don't know. So
the numbers are in decline. Kids aren't playing football as much. I mean, the numbers are way down.
Parents freaked out. I mean, when all that stuff hit the news, it was like, I had parents, friends of mine were like, nope, you want to kick? You can kick. You can be a kicker. That's it. Yeah. That's all we're going to let you do. So, you know, hopefully the sport will keep improving. It's tech.
Yeah,
maybe we can get some great American manufactured, some great innovation figuring out how to keep these people safe.
Yeah, yeah, the helmet. Did you see that Boston Globe just ran this, that they think that it's possible that the shooter up in Maine, the guy who killed 18 mm-hmm. people, he may have been a victim of CTE. Apparently, had been exposed to like concussive devices. And it's a serious, serious problem.
Yeah. It's very depressing when people get hurt on the thing. And it's, I look at it and sometimes these guys like fall in such a way. And they bounce right up and they're like, yeah. And I'm like, if I felt like that once, I would never get up. I would just lay there for weeks, writhing.
Like, you're cracking me up right now. So a little inside for everybody. It's like, I have invited Greg to come ski, ice skate, something, anything. He's like, no. I don't do anything like that. What's your line?
I won't do anything that I'm, you know, if I'm going to get hurt doing it, I ain't doing it. You know, if there's any risk of getting hurt.
If there's any risk.
I mean, other than sitting in an airplane with the door flying off.
Exactly. That's what's going to happen. They're going to be like, oh no, he was sitting with a seatbelt on and it didn't work out.
I don't like speed that, but I would go skydiving before I went skiing, honestly. I would rather do that.
Oh my God.
Okay.
Yeah. That's interesting. I'm not going to do either one though. Newsflash.
No,
okay.
No, you're not.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So,
we have announcements.
We have announcements, and I forgot to put the timer on that last segment. So sorry, Rachel, we're keeping you on late, but we'll make it quick at the end. What are our announcements?
I don't have any. Rachel, what's going on with the book? Are you on a tour? Are you doing more events? Like what's going on with it?
Yeah, I'm. I have a C-SPAN thing coming up. There's a rumor. I've heard The Economist is going to run something, possibly maybe if everybody pulls together and prays for me in The New Yorker, which would just be a super coup, and then I can die. And then in terms of talking, like we're working on that, you know. I'd like some excitement to build first, and then I would like to travel around and talk to people because everybody's got a story about this, right? So many people whose family was in manufacturing or they were in manufacturing, like already, you know, I've been getting emails and emails and emails of people who have the stories about this stuff. So it's wonderful to see.
It's a great time for this conversation. Yeah, it's a great time for this conversation. So. Yeah.
I love it. There's lots of, there's something good is going to come out of this. I think something like that, you know, some person will innovate something and you'll figure it out. It'll be good.
That'd be wonderful.
Yeah.
Well, when you have a schedule and when you start to go around and talk and you have a schedule, come back, let us know, make sure we have it so we can post it for everybody. But in the meantime, everyone run out and get the book, and it's available. Yeah. I'm assuming on Amazon, even though,
or I not Amazon. You can not Amazon.
You can go to a bookstore and support your local bookstore.
Yeah. But yeah, it is available on Amazon. I would love to hear what people think. You know, I really tried to write it as a narrative, you know, really following this young couple as they just struggle through this. And they knew as much as you and I do about manufacturing, but they somehow made it work.
Wonderful. Okay.
Yeah. Last topic.
A little entertainment. Why were we talking about this? Oh, because the Golden Globes.
The Golden Globes. But there's one thing first, real quick.
Yeah.
Which is the AI thing with the AI George Carlin. They're going to create this, and I don't know how they're allowed to do this. They're feeding George Carlin, you know, who's best stand-up, whatever. It's awesome, into the AI. And my thing is like, even if no one's doing the AI Rodney Dangerfield, because even in the afterlife, no respect at all. None. Mm.
Yeah. His daughter's pretty opposed. Carlin's daughter is pretty opposed to this, as one would understand. This is going to be very tricky to watch, because if
it's not going to be tricky to watch, because I ain't watching it.
I understand. No, but I mean, the evolution of this. If man has really created something to replace our humanity, which is what, I don't know anything that's a better articulation of the force of human, of the individual human spirit and mind, than a brilliant stand-up comic, right? And the ability to have commentary and a point of view that is very specific to one human being than a stand-up comic. So I'm a little freaked out about this. We'll see. I think, I don't know. It's not good. It's not good for me. I'll tell you that.
AI really channeled George Carlin, it would just be like, this sucks. I'm AI.
If it can appropriate a voice like that, and then not just mimic it, but create. I don't know.
No.
I don't know what to say. It doesn't. That takes me to doom and gloom. So let's go to the Globe.
You can't. Man, he's irreplicable. Come on.
I don't
irreplicable.
I don't know about
all right. What's up with the Golden Globes? I didn't even know they were on.
We didn't even know they were on. I think, you know, the Golden Globes, there was a, it was terrible. I missed the first part of it as a show, Yeah. I missed the first part of it. I didn't realize it was even on. And then I caught it. So the host is getting a lot of criticism, a very hard job. You know, I'm not going to criticize somebody's terrible job to have. I would never want that
job. Who was the host?
I don't know his name. Joe somebody. I've never. No point. I'm a little out of it. I got to say, I'm realizing half some of the faces and some of the things. I'm like, what? Who?
What's Who is it, Rachel?
I'm starting to get old in that way.
Joe Coy, right?
Joe Coy. Okay. I had never heard of this comedian. It's a comedian, I'm assuming, because they only, I've never heard. So anyway, that aside, the Hollywood Foreign Press had a rebrand. I didn't know they rebranded. I knew there was controversy that they got called to the carpet on because there wasn't a single person of color in the whole Hollywood Foreign Press. It was like, what? I mean, you're literally outside of this country. You're literally supposed to be a representation of every other things. How is it just a bunch of white people? It just was strange. But that doesn't surprise me anyway. So they addressed that. They rebranded themselves, some new name. I don't know what that is. But it seemed like the same old award show, and it seemed like the same old thing. So Golden Globes are that party, as you guys all know, that sort of like it is foreign press. It is entertainment industry reporting. And they're the ones that are voting, like critics and things. And they're the ones voting on the movie. So you saw the list and television and film. It's combined television and film. And they had some new categories, which was interesting. They have like a box office category. I can't remember some of the other new ones. Oh, they had a stand-up. Had a stand-up category.
They did.
For stand-up specials. Yeah. So that's nice. I actually think that's great. I think it's good for the industry, and I think it's appropriate, right? If you and I had this conversation about James Cameron of like, it's like another filmmaker that for me, I can't take anything away from somebody who can write a four quadrant film that's a blockbuster and do it in such a way that regardless of your age, your gender, your language, your history, your nation of origin, your cultural, regardless of all that palette of history, that you end up having this global, that you hit some kind of universal storytelling thing that all these people like it, you know, equally. That's, it's like the super, super hard thing to do. I don't even know how to express how hard that is to do. It is so hard to do. So again, I don't take anything. I'm glad there's a category now for that. So that's it. But you had some, you were looking at some of the winners and losers and you were like, you had some opinions about it.
I just had one hot take, but Rachel, are you into this? Do you pay attention to this stuff or you not, did you see things that you like this year? What's your, where are you? And I mean, if you don't, that's fine.
I could give you my Barbie screed, but like I would be very much alone.
Do the Barbie screed.
Do the Barbie screed. It's okay. You didn't care for it.
So like the director, I went to Barnard College. So you know, I feel like I can say something about Greta Gerwig and about fourth wave feminism or wherever we are at this point. And I thought that the movie was extremely problematic because in my version of feminism, when I came of age in feminism, whatever that means, I don't know what that means. The idea was that it was inclusive. So the idea was that we were finding a place for men and women to work alongside each other and get equal pay and, you know, hold equal numbers of positions of power, that sort of thing. And I was just like flabbergasted that it was presenting this like extremely frightening and problematic view of some new feminism that's exclusive to women only. And I guess a lot of women found that empowering because clearly, you know, it was a huge hit and it really resonated with a lot of people. But for me, I thought this is exactly where we are in the problem that, you know, if you're cutting out men, and if you're saying that men are ancillary or decorative or whatever it is, like if that's the vision that you're working toward, you know, we're never going to win this thing. Nobody's going to win. Nobody's going to win. It's going to be a tragedy. It's going to be a mess. So that's my take. I'm sorry.
No, that's a good take.
That was interesting. I think it's interesting.
I like the take. Elby, what do you think of the take?
I like it. I like the take.
What's your take?
My take on it was, a white hot spotlight on what we are up against as a society, because of how we evolved, and it reduced to the ridiculousness of it all. So I engaged with it as a ridiculous commentary, and what we agree on this is, I didn't see it as a woman empowerment. Da, da, da. You know, I had people saying, "Go, you got to take your daughter," and you know, my daughter hasn't seen it yet. She's fine. She's good. It's not. It wasn't that journey for me. But it was a Ryan Gosling performance for the ages. I just really engaged with his performance, and so that was like the one thing, like, Greg and I were talking about. We were saying, "Oh, what should we do for the Globes in the upcoming award season?" So the Globes are also sort of a bellwether. Everyone looks at it and says, "Is that what it's going to be like when we get to these bigger award shows?" And in terms of who wins and who takes the prize home, and so we were both really disappointed. As wonderful as Robert Downey Jr. is, just super disappointed that Ryan Gosling didn't get an Oscar for that performance. I mean, and I think as an actor, if you're walking into a role like that, where the character has that level of specificity and those kinds of lines that are just coming off the tongue like that, and you're in the situation where you're being ridiculous, yet it is a commentary. I would think that would be super fun to play. So I just, for me, it was that. It wasn't anything more than that. That's all it was.
Yeah, I think your take is good. I think the movie is problematic in a lot of ways. First of all, I think it exists to trigger like the Ben Shapiro's of the world, which it did. I watched it. I went to see it after that whole thing, and I was like, "Oh God, this movie." It's almost like they sat around and were trying intentionally to.
Yeah,
the whole movie is about Ken. The movie's about Ken. It's just he's the most interesting character, and, exactly. You know.
Yeah,
and he's the idea that it's like in Toy Story where. You know, Buzz Lightyear doesn't realize he's a toy until later, and the movie is about him realizing he's a toy. Ken doesn't realize that, you know, what he is, that he's this ancillary piece of the Barbie universe.
Well, as soon as he figured out it wasn't about horses, he was.
Yeah, but the beginning, he doesn't understand it at all, that he doesn't have a soul, that he's like, you know, and I think to your point, Rachel, it's like it's flipped, you know, you know, it's a matriarchy or whatever in that Barbie land. And when Ken goes outside, he's like, "Oh, this is not supposed to," you know, and then he has to figure it out. He has to balance it. And by the end of the movie, he sort of achieves the balance. But that's the movie. That's who changes in the movie, right? Is this Barbie change?
He's the arc.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. And it's such a subtle performance. It's such a, you know, Robert Downey Jr. is one because he had fucking makeup on. I'm sorry. He's fine. He's a great actor, obviously. It's fine. It's not complicated. There's different levels of it, I think. There's different roles that, you know, you're going to be good in this particular, like, okay, you know, Judi Dench playing M in Skyfall is just, that's just, you know, whatever. It's fine. It doesn't require any great, you know.
You don't know that. I don't know.
I just saw the movie. She's not my job,
so I'm like,
I feel like
I don't judge.
Whereas Bryan Cranston playing Walter White, like the physicality and all of the new, like it's just so much. Well, so much more to do.
So much more. And then on your favorite TV shows, Succession did win a lot. Do you watch Succession, Rachel?
No, I haven't.
Oh, Rachel, we got to get you on there. It won. It kind of looks like that's gonna. It's the year for that sweeping a bunch of stuff. So
that ship has sailed, and it sailed through the Red Sea straight up the Suez Canal. That's where it's.
Yeah.
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 Just to bring it around full circle.
I will say, just in terms of a, I don't know if anyone here has seen Saltburn. I understand that a lot of people might not like that movie. There's been some voice not like, you know, it's very confronting. But oh my God, I love that movie. I think Rachel, I think that it, in contrast to Barbie, that maybe sit, and then you'll be like, you can reach out to me and probably say, why did you make recommend I watch this movie? But it's a, it is a, it's a, it's a, it's like, the talented Mr. Ripley took a hit of acid is what it is.
Oh, great. I love it. Yeah, yeah. My daughter wants me to see it. So the movie that I just saw last night, which I would love to talk to you guys about, but you probably haven't seen it yet, is called American Fiction.
Yeah, I saw it. Oh, sure.
You have
to vote on these things. Yeah, yeah. So
you're a voter.
I vote for the writers. I loved it. Did you like it?
I did. I thought it was really wild. I had a lot of fun with that. But okay, good. So we'll talk about that at some point. Yeah. I thought it was also fun just coming at it from a writer perspective.
From a writer, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
I did really feel like the way they did it. So for people, that's the Jeffrey Wright movie, and he's a writer that writes, but who happens to be Black. That's sort of like his thing. He's like, he's just a writer. He's writing what interests him and what he's talented at. And his books are brilliant, but they don't sell like, you know, because there's a genre of like Black, you know, American voices writing the African-American experience and, you know, with the stuff. So he gets so frustrated at a certain point that he just spits out this novel that's supposedly a memoir about him. And he's like a criminal or whatever. His agent makes that up. And it's got all the tropes in it, but it ends up being the thing that's like the biggest book of the year, right? And everyone's like, it's going to be nominated, da, da, da. So he's sort of going on that journey while also dealing with tragedy and loss of his family and trying to figure out how to navigate just who he is as a son and a brother. I think it's a great movie. I really enjoyed it. There's a little unevenness in it for me, but just... as a writer, I did think that, boy, he churned that book out really quick. So that was I bumped on that pretty hard of like, it was like he wrote a novel in 2 weeks. I don't know, Greg, what do you think?
And I love
Jack
that
Kerouac
scene.
Wrote On the Road in 2 weeks.
And on
and
a
it
scroll?
Sucked, and it's a piece of shit. So
it is, you know, a piece of shit. But do you know that he did it on a scroll? It wasn't sheets of paper, it was a scroll. I love that scene where he's got the two guys, his two protagonists in the room with him as he's writing.
Good. Yeah, yeah. There was
In the middle of this very intense scene between these two thug protagonists, it turns out it's a father and a son and there's a gun involved. One of the protagonists turns to the writer and says, "Wait, that line doesn't work for me." It was so great. It was just really fun.
It is fun. It's a fun movie, so that's good. And I think he got nominated. He could have gotten I don't know. He was in the running. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the other big thing that in terms of I don't know if we talked about Maestro. Have you seen Maestro?
Mm-hmm.
Let It Burn. Okay. So in this house, we know a lot about Leonard Bernstein. I know the least amount. You know, my parents certainly, because he was a big political figure in his time, even as a conductor and a composer and a musician, and that was completely left out of the film, which was a little bumpy. But that's something where there's the film, there's the screenplay and the movie, and then there are the performances. And my husband's father was founder of the Juilliard Quartet and played with Bernstein and went to Tanglewood, and they would do master classes. I'm like, I'm just finding this out, right? And so I'm saying to my husband, I'm like, well, you know, where were you? And he's like, I was in yoga. Because, you know, that was his parents and his dad and his mom too, and their job. And I was like, so you like grew up with Leonard Bernstein, which I kind of know, but like literally when he would do his master classes and his teaching with your dad, and you didn't attend any of that? You didn't like, you didn't go and see them? He's like, no, my dad, I didn't. Why would I do that? It's his work. So that was a really, in that way, the movie then hit me differently because it was about his family and it was about what that life was like for them, especially his wife, played by Carey Mulligan. So
I thought he was gay, right? Did that come out?
Yes, very much so. And so, but very much loved her. And so, and they very much had a marriage and a family. So that became more interesting. But I will say, so Bradley Cooper does Bernstein when he conducted the Mahler, right, in the cathedral, which is a very famous recording, and it was a broadcast and all this. And it just, even talking about it right now, it just gives me chills that not only how he did it, it's like such a hard thing to do. It's not like you're just, you know, you're picking up on a gift, doing it, that gift that also takes years, decades, like of knowledge and understanding to be able to conduct that. It just was unreal. And the way that he gave that tribute to Bernstein, I've never seen an artist do something like that for another artist. I think actually I loved, there's some performances I love, like I loved Philip Seymour Hoffman's performance of Capote, but we're seeing the process that he was in that and his life. We didn't actually, it's hard. You're not going to show a writer writing, right? You're going to show the writer having the experience of connecting to the material. But this was seeing someone conduct. So I don't know. I think it's worth, I think it was an incredible performance. I think he deserves every accolade, and it's a little odd, I think. And
that's what I mean, though, about the complexity, the amount of effort that it's, or whatever the word is, it's harder. That's a harder role to play than what what's his name did in Oppenheimer. Just this.
Yeah, but they weren't, that was supporting. Right? Yeah.
It doesn't matter, but it's still, it's not the, that's what I'm talking about. I don't mean that he's bad in him. I just mean he didn't have to do as much. The degree of difficulty is less. That's what I mean. It's a higher degree of difficulty to do that part. So
I recommend seeing it just to see that performance. Okay. But anyway, that's our entertainment. I don't think there's anything else happening in entertainment. There's nothing newsy unless I missed it.
No, there's nothing. There's nothing.
Taylor newsy. Swift owns the world. That's it.
Yeah. I don't know.
She's now being called, because the football MAGA people are so upset that the cameras go to her that they're saying she's a CIA asset that's been trained and groomed and elevated to shape the narrative and control how votes are going so that the liberals can. I'm not kidding you.
No, Jesse Waters did a show about it last week. Yeah.
Yeah. This is a big conspiracy theory that's brewing. Poor Taylor Swift.
I need her to like work her magic powers and get Travis Kelce to get open on these drives. That's what we'll need here. Yeah, we'll see. Rachel Slade, thanks again for joining us. This was a lot of fun.
Thanks for hanging out as we do casual talk, which we don't normally do. But
that was nice.
Yeah. Again, Making It in America. Good luck with the book and all the events coming out about it. Thank you, everybody, for watching. We appreciate you hitting the like button. And if you want to join, there are benefits to joining. So we're not going to do an after hours today, but we're going to do one probably next week. And if you join, you get to come on. And, you know, basically, you know what after hours is, LB? It's like our Mojo Dojo Casa house. That's what it is. It's the 5-8 Mojo Dojo Casa house. And...
I kind of want to play it again. All right.
All right. Good night, everybody.
Good night, everybody.
Thanks for watching. We'll be right back.
Everything is stupid. Everything is dumb when Koff is your king. Everything is stupid. Leaving everything. Everything is worse with Nazis on the platform. It's all fascist and rapist and anti-vax morons in mega heaven. There's no doubt that they pulled down their pants just to count to 11. Everything is stupid.